And I will ask Dr. Zhai from China to develop to give a lecture on the algorithm for the diagnosis and treatment of COVID-19 associated VTE. The reason for which we promote in the first place the VTE subject is not because we are clotters, it's because China is about 6 or 7 hours in front of us, and it is already too late there. And so after the end of Dr. Zhai's presentation, we will do the discussion in order to leave him free, because tomorrow he has a very hard day at the hospital. So, Professor Zhai, please share your screen and start.
And in this topic, I already said I will talk about the current status, the diagnosis, and also the treatment. How about the condition of COVID-19 in China and also the world? This is the data from the June 6th. I think that's the most recent data. You could see the condition in China is much better than ever before. Only a very small number of patients confirms with COVID-19 left. But the data from the world is still very, very serious. There are still so many patients with COVID-19 diagnosed, and also so many patients died. If I want to see the appearance from China, I think the social distance is the most important thing, and the facial mask play a very important role in the protection of all the population in China. And nowadays, the condition of China becomes back to a normal life, and we can just live like a normal life. I think we should expand our concept to try to protect the population from using a facial mask, and also the social distance also important for this. How about the DVT and the PE in COVID-19? Just now, there are so many patients died during the treatment with COVID-19. Most physicians might think that maybe due to the acute respiratory distress syndrome or infection itself. But according to our experience, in the early stage of our clinical experience, just as this patient, from a long window, we can see some shadow. The patient was confirmed with COVID-19. But the patient have very high level edema and also very severe short breaths. So the physician in the hospital performed the CT pulmonary angiogram for the patient. We did find some line clot in the pulmonary artery, both in the right side and also left side. The patient was confirmed with pulmonary embolism, and we gave the patient low molecular weight heparin at first, and then transferred to rilorospan after discharge. And after 3 months follow-up, the patient recovered very well. And how about the DVT and the PE in the COVID-19 patient according to the studies? This study just published, I think, last month from Circulation from one of my colleagues in Wuhan. And in this study, altogether about 143 patients hospitalized with COVID-19. Among them, 66 patients developed DVT, and 23 patients with proximal DVT, and 43 patients with distal DVT. And we also found that there's a worse prognosis in the DVT patient. In the DVT group, about 35 patients died, but in the non-DVT group, about nine patients died. That means DVT is the prognosis of the patient. How about the study all over the world? We just asked one of my fellow, put all the studies together. From here, we can find the studies from not only from China, but also from some European countries. Maybe some colleagues here already read through the paper. We could find that from Netherlands, from France, from China, from Italy. We could find the incidence of DVT and PE is among 4% to 24%. I think it's very high, and it's not the final data, because not all the patients were performed with ultrasound or CT pulmonary angiogram. That means the incidence might be much higher than the articles have been reported. So we should pay more attention to that. Just now, we just said there's so many patients died during the treatment. How about the reason of death? This study just published in Annals of Internal Medicine. They performed autopsy findings of 12 patients. Among the 12 patients, 7 patients revealed DVT, and 4 patients revealed pulmonary embolism. And the pulmonary embolism is the direct reason for the death. And from the picture here, we can see the big clot in the pulmonary artery and also a big clot in the deep veins. So we might be hypothesis that some patient died might be due to PE or due to some other thrombosis episode. So why the patient of COVID-19 have a high risk of VTE? I think many physicians here are very familiar with some risk factors, such as fever, dehydration, and some gastrointestinal symptoms, inflammation, and also application of hormone and immunoglobulin. All these factors combined together could get hypercoagulability. And some other factors such as infection, confined to bed, obesity, reduced morbidity, hypertension, coma, shock, sedation, and also mechanical ventilation can cause venous stasis. And also some other reasons such as infusion, venous indwelling needle, and the mechanical ventilation, and also the central venous catheterization. And some patients might be performed with surgery or trauma, and all the factors together can get induced injury. And we can imagine that most of the patients have at least one or two or even three factors of a short treat, including the induced injury, blood flow stasis, hypercoagulability. All the three factors combined together, if they occur successively or simultaneously, and it will significantly increase the VTE risk. That may explain the reason why the VTE is very high in the patient with COVID-19. I think not only in the DVT and PE, but also some other pathology or pathophysiology phenomena such as pulmonary incital thrombosis could also be occurred in this kind of patient. How about the diagnosis of DVT and PE in this kind of patient? If the patient in the treatment during the COVID-19, if we find asymmetric pain, sweating, or discomfort presenting in a unilateral or bilateral lower extremities, and especially in some patients with central venous catheterization, if we find superficial venous feeding in the extremities of the catheterization site, maybe the DVT might occur in this kind of patient. For some patients, if chest pain, hemoptysis, dyspnea, hypoxemia, and some other symptoms couldn't be explained by the underlying disease such as COVID-19 itself, maybe we can think PE might occur in this kind of patient. So a regular monitoring of the COVID-19 is very important. If some symptoms such as the edema, such as the short breath or occurred in the kind of patient, the physician should be vigilant for the occurrence of DVT and PE. And if there's a sharp increase of D-dimer, maybe we think try to find the evidence of DVT and PE, or maybe some other phenomena such as inflammatory stone could also increase the D-dimer level. In case of the DVT and PE suspicion, careful bedside clinical examination is very important for this kind of patient. We can use the echo Doppler ultrasound to confirm DVT. We can also use the CT pulmonary angiogram for the diagnosis of PE. But during the diagnosis of DVT and PE, we should think of the mandatory clinical and protective conditions of the patient. How about the patient clinical highly suspect PE? If there's a clinical evidence of a lower extremity DVT or right heart sudden breath, it's not necessary for us to do anything more, just treat the patient at acute PE. If there's some unidentical or protection resource are adequate, we can perform CT pulmonary angiogram. If there's a severe conditions or related examinations cannot be done due to the limited resource, we can try to initiate anticoagulation. And if there's a sudden death or aggression with the symptoms of high-risk PE, such as the low blood pressure or a cardiac arrest, for this condition, I think the bedside echocardiography is very important for this. And thrombolysis should be considered for this kind of patient. How about the treatment of low myelitic with heparin for the patient? If there's no confirm, but we suspect patients with high risk of VTE and with some relevant examinations, I think we can try to start anticoagulation with low myelitic with heparin as the first line treatment. If there's no contraindications such as active bleeding for the patient. And for the high-risk PE patient, there's such as some high-risk PE, such as hypertension, and also the hemodynamic deterioration or sudden cardiac arrest. If we think the diagnosis of PE is very, the possibility is very high, and also have some evidence from the bedside echocardiogram and the risk of thrombolysis could be considered for this kind of patient. And for some critical ill patients, such as refractory circular collapse or cardiac arrest, I think we can choose the ECMO for the first choice. And a surgical epilectomy or catheter-directed treatment for the patient if the condition is permitted for this kind of patient. So I just know I briefly talked about the diagnosis and treatment strategies for COVID-19 associated VTE, but I think we still have so many other unanswered issues of DVT and PE associated with COVID-19. How about etiology or COVID-19 per se? Might be due to the some inflammatory. Still, some other biomarkers could be have a strong relationship with this coagular per se. And how about the D-dimer? How about the PT, APTT, and some biomarkers in the development of this condition? We should think about it. And how about the usage of some assessment methods, such as Weill score and JDRF score, in the utility of DVT and PE assessment? Maybe some confusion part, because the symptoms of COVID-19 is very atypical. So many conditions or symptoms will combine with the DVT and PE and also COVID-19. And how about the usage of unfractionated heparin and DOAX in COVID-19 patient? For some severe renal impairment patient and for some high-risk PE requiring thrombolysis, before the thrombolysis and after thrombolysis, we can use the unfractionated heparin for the patient. In terms of DOAX, DOAX is very easy for the physicians to use it. And it's very convenient, it's oral, it's not necessary for us to monitor the levels of the anticoagulation. But during the acute phase of COVID-19 treatment, generally we use antiviral drugs or antibacterial drugs, or there's still so many complications. So many drugs will be used during the process of treatment of COVID-19. Drug-drug interaction should be considered for this kind of patient. So in our guidelines and in my clinical viewpoint, we suggest in the acute phase, if there's so many drug used for the patient, we suggest using low myelitic heparin. But after discharge, if there's no other drug-drug interactions, we can switch to rivaroxaban or dabigatran for the patient. That may be better for us to treat the patient. And how about the dimer? Many physicians might think the dimer is very non-specific, but in my opinion, it's very useful. We can use the dimer for the diagnosis and also for the clinical decision. We can also use the dimer to guide the therapy. If the dimer level is normal, I think we can just, also other condition normal, we can just discharge the patient early. If there's a mild or moderate increase of the dimer, and we can try to assess the risk of VTE. If there's a very high level of the dimer, maybe VTE might suspect, or there may be other possibilities such as the infection or COVID-19 inflammatory storm. And if there's a mild elevation with clinical risk of VTE, we can give the patient a prophylaxis dosage of normalized heparin. And if there's a moderate elevation with clinical risk of VTE, and we can give the patient treatment dosage. But sometimes give the patient a treatment dosage, but the condition of the patient might deteriorate, or there's a very high level elevation of D-dimer. Maybe difficult for us to just explain it in using the VTE or some other. We can try to think of high risk of VTE or some inflammatory storm. We can try to think about the thrombolysis and also think about some aggressive treatment such as ECMO or such as some other cardiopulmonary support technique for this patient. So I think VTE in COVID-19 is a very common issue. It's a very critical problem for the patient with COVID-19. The diagnosis and treatment might be difficult for us in the contamination period. We should try to think about the protection of patient. So the clinical assessment and the bedside method is very important for the diagnosis. And the use of heparins and other treatments should be considered for the patient, but drug-drug interaction should be considered during the treatment of COVID-19. And also there's still unanswered issues, such as how about the evaluation of the dimer and how about other markers. There's still so much for us to do or to think about in the future research. And I think we still have a long way for the COVID-19 associated VTE, but we still have great hope. And here I want to thanks all so many colleagues from European, also from Canada, and also so many colleagues in China. We have make so much effort for the COVID-19 treatment or management. In this February, we already published guidelines in Chinese version, and the month before we published in the Thrombosis and Hepatitis Journal in an English version. And here I do want to thank all the colleagues who help us to fulfill this guidelines. I think these guidelines might be useful for the colleagues in not only in China but also in European countries or some other countries in the world. And finally, I would like to appreciate all the colleagues here and all the physicians who are fighting on the front line of the COVID-19 patient. I think if we work together, if we try our best to put our effort together, I think COVID-19 might be disappeared in the near future. And thank you so much for your attention. Thanks a lot.